Hey, good afternoon, Prague. My name is Didrik. I am a C# developer, and I'm here to share my experience in working as a C# developer with ML.NET. Last year, during the holiday season, I had a little bit too much time, and I started playing with ML.NET, and I have since then been using it in applications. After the working hours, I found the time to create a little UWP application that hosts 11 different machine learning scenarios using ML.NET, and I published that on GitHub, and each page in that sample app has its own blog post. If you Google for Zamelbrewer, my alter ego, you will very rapidly find these resources. Spoiler alert, I'm going to tell you during this session that ML.NET is very useful technology. Although it appeared officially this year, it is a very mature product. It has a very long history, actually, inside Microsoft. It is not something exotic. Your C# development team most probably has already all the skills to start embedding machine learning into your application. And I'm also pretty confident that it works on the machines that your applications are now running on, with maybe a couple of exceptions, but I'm pretty confident that it is immediately useful for you in your C# applications. Well, what is ML.NET? It's a .NET library that adds machine learning capabilities to your application. But machine learning is a technology that allows computers to look at existing data and then find patterns in it in order to forecast future behaviors and trends. Without being explicitly programmed, you don't need extra C# or whatever language to run a machine learning model. ML.NET is exposed to you as a set of NuGet packages that run on .NET Core and .NET Framework. So I'm pretty confident that it will run inside your applications. It doesn't require any exotic technology, no IDE, no cloud resources, and so on, which for a lot of .NET development teams is probably good news. I refer here to the homepage of ML.NET itself, where they say, okay, the intention of ML.NET is to program the unprogrammable. Typical use case scenarios you have over here, sentiment analysis of text, customer segmentation is something that we are going to do in a couple of minutes, sales spike detection, detecting objects in photos, recommending products, things that Amazon and Netflix do all the time, predicting the price of, for example, real estate or second-hand cars or taxi drives and things like that, fraud detection, sales forecasting, and so on. There's a whole range of problems that you can tackle with machine learning in a very easy way. The typical example of deep learning is detecting objects in images. That's not something that is only useful for self-driving cars. Some TV companies also should have done that. But okay, this is an example of programming the unprogrammable. Let's say you have a use case. Your customer wants you to recognize in images whether or not there is wine or coffee in them. You may be the greatest C# developer on earth, and you may be the best SQL specialist on earth. There is no way that you can identify that coffee mug with for each if then else select start from on error resume next. There's no way you find that coffee mug. And actually, using machine learning, it's a very simple problem. So that's why we are going to use ML.NET in our application to program the so-called unprogrammable. Now, what is a ML.NET model? Well, basically, for you as an application developer, you can consider an ML.NET model to be a zip file that you can load into your application and ask a specific question. What is the price of a taxi fare? Is this a good wine or not? Things like that. Nothing more, nothing less. Basically, in machine learning, you're going to collect data, you're going to clean it up, you're going to train a model to identify patterns in that model, but that's an offline activity. That's something that you do in console applications, in Windows services, and so on. The model that is produced is, if it's ML.NET, saved as a zip file. And in your WPF, UWP, ASP.NET applications, you are going to load that zip file in order to ask it some questions. Okay, I already mentioned that ML.NET is very mature. Well, there are parts of the code that are 2 decades old. It started as an internal project at Microsoft. It was written in .NET 1, C# version 1. And it slowly grew into a lot of Microsoft internal products, Office, Bing, Visual Studio, IntelliCode, for example, is written in ML.NET. And well, last but not least, ML.NET is actually also used inside Azure Machine Learning Studio. A couple of years ago, it was decided to bring that internal product to the public, and they have started rewriting it, updating the .NET 1 code to the latest versions, cleaning up the APIs, removing the Microsoft-specific stuff in there. And as you see, last year, in the middle of last year, it appeared on GitHub as an open source project, ML.NET 0.1. In May of this year, it was officially released as 1.0. And today we are at, well, last time I checked anyway, we were at 1.4 preview 2. It evolves very rapidly. Now, if you want to do your first steps in machine learning, you will very rapidly discover that that world is totally dominated by a language called Python, which is a very good language. And most of these machine learning environments are fantastic tools. But if you are a .NET development team, and you want to take your first steps in machine learning, and you have to start learning new paradigms, new concepts, new programming languages, new development environments, and then find a way to run the models that you create in those exotic environments in your C# code, that's pretty far outside of your comfort zone. So I have good news for you. Those of you who recognized Monty Python in this picture, this is the only Python you need to know to start with machine learning. Those who didn't recognize Monty Python, you also know enough Python to start with machine learning in .NET. Because ML.NET is entirely written in C#. It's even a relatively readable source code. It's all on GitHub. Prerequisites, okay, I already mentioned it. It runs on .NET Core, it runs on .NET Framework. So I'm pretty confident that you'll be able to download a NuGet package, attach it to your solution, and you will be able to embed ML.NET features in your applications. If you have some exotic hardware, you might need to read the fine print. Some of the algorithms don't work on all of the platforms. This is how a typical machine learning case looks like. You have to get data. And that doesn't have to be a large amount of data, as I will show you later on, but you do have to have some raw data available. The second step is always preparing that data for the algorithm. Most machine learning algorithms only like numerical input. So you have to translate your texts and strings and things like that, category names and things like that. You have to translate that to numbers. Basically, what you're going to do is you're going to present that model with a data set that it never saw, but of which you know what the model should do with it. You run the model on that data set, and you compare the output of the model with what you think the output should be of the model. And then you can easily evaluate whether the model suits your use case or not. And then there is most probably the creation of the zip file. When you're happy with your model, you're going to persist it, save it as a zip file, and then use it in your applications. That's not a mandatory step, by the way. If the training of the model goes fast enough, you can do that inside your application. In many cases, it's just a matter of seconds. Okay, let's map that typical use case on the API of ML.NET. Well, there is an API to work with data, to prepare data, to train and evaluate models, to save it as a zip file, and so on. I'm not going too much in detail, but some core API elements. You always need to create, as a developer, an ML context. That's the catalog where everything starts. It's like the object context in Entity Framework. There's a very rich iDataView API that allows you to work with data. And then there are components that transform data, components that create components that transform data, and okay, last but not least, there are prediction functions, which is what we are going to use in our apps. Let's start with the first example. Let's start with unsupervised learning. Let's do some clustering. Clustering is an example of unsupervised learning. That means I'm not going to give labels to the data. I just have here a couple of dots on the chart, and I'm going to ask machine learning to create groups of dots that belong together. And that's it. Divide the data in three groups. Divide the data in seven groups. That's it. This is an example of that app that I wrote over the last couple of months. Typical scenario for clustering. I am the owner of a shopping mall, and I know a lot about my customers. I know their gender, their income, how much they spend, etc. But I have a tight marketing budget. I can invite some of these people to come to receptions with champagne and caviar and free Tesla test drives. And to other people, I can send vouchers, okay? Buy three, pay two, and things like that. And you know that if you send the wrong invitation to the wrong person, you're just throwing away your money. Well, a good start to solving this problem is divide your customers into groups. And then dive into the groups to see why, what they have in common, and then you can decide on how to target these groups with different marketing campaigns. And this is the scenario I started with. I have a lot of customers that, of which I know how much they spend and how much they earn. And I'm going to use ML.NET to divide that into five clusters. Yeah, that's an easy one. Eh? Okay, you immediately see where the five clusters should be. It's a good idea to start with machine learning, with those easy things that you can easily verify. This is the result of the algorithm. My customers are divided into five groups, and I have a model to which I can ask questions. If I input, like over there, an annual income and a spending score, the model can immediately say, okay, the user belongs, you don't see the mouse. Okay, if I say, if I have a new customer in my shopping mall, and I know he earns $90,000 per year, and he has a spending score of 35, the model immediately returns the cluster. How did that work? Now, we started with raw data. I started with a comma-separated data set with some information, customer ID, gender, age, etc. I was only interested in annual income and spending score, so I created an input class for that. I created an ML context because you always needed that, and I used the text loader to load that data. Okay, at the bottom of the slides, you each time have the phase where you are. There is 5 phases. I forgot to mention that if you are creating a scenario in ML.NET for those 5 phases, and it takes longer than 10 lines of C# to code it, then you made a mistake, okay? That's how easy it is, that's how straightforward it is. A whole scenario of building and training a model should not take more than 10 lines of C#, which is very good news. So, okay, I created an ML context, and using a text loader, I'm loading the information into a data view, actually. So I have the raw data. Next step is, in general, well, choosing the exact algorithm for your problem. Okay, it's an easy, this one. Clustering has only one algorithm in ML.NET, so the choice is relatively limited. Fortunately, well, K-means is a very good algorithm. So see, there's not much that you should know. If you know that you have to do clustering, well, this is the way to do it. You have to prepare the data. In this case, I'm going to create a vector called features with the values of annual income and spending score, because I mentioned already that the algorithms expect a certain input. Most of them expect a label and a feature vector. So I created a feature vector for the clustering trainer. And then I'm specifying that I need 5 clusters. Well, and that's it. That's preparing the raw data. That's one line of code. Building the model is just one call, where you give the data, you feed it into the pipeline with a call to fit, and that will actually train the model. And we're already at step 3. It goes fast. The algorithm will provide some output. It will actually give the predicted cluster name. It will use the name predicted label. So I created an output class over here for the algorithm. It also returns the distances of the data item that you just provided to the different cluster nodes. Testing the model, well, okay, blank. We are in unsupervised learning. You don't have a list of clusters in mind before you create the model, so you cannot compare any output. Testing the model in unsupervised learning, 0 lines of code. Saving the model, okay, model.save. How easy can it get? And the result of that is a zip file. Depending on the algorithm, the zip file can be very big or very small. In this case, the model only needs to persist the 5 centers of the clusters. So it can do that in 3 kilobytes. You can open those zip files, by the way. It's pretty readable XML. Some models are lazy, and they just store all the data that they will be used to train with. That's why for the classification model, for example, you have 2.5 megabytes. For consuming the model, there are 2 ways. You can call the transform method that transforms a whole data view, a whole list of records, into a whole list of output records. That's what I used to color the dots in the diagram. I wasn't interested you're interested in finding one particular cluster number for one particular data item. I want to have it for everything, and that's a classical transform call. Or you can create a prediction function, which is a function that is specialized in transforming one input into one output. So you provide it annual income and spending score, and it will give you a cluster number. I've heard that not all of you own a shopping mall, and not all of you are in marketing. So I can imagine that you say, well, that's not for me. What can I do in my applications with clustering? Well, let me give you an example. I'm pretty sure that you all use Excel from time to time. And also from time to time, you are going to want a diagram in your Excel sheet. And there is that nice feature in Excel. You select a portion in your data, and then you click the button, I want to have that in a diagram. And then immediately, Excel comes up with this very nice dialogue, and it proposes for you the diagrams that it thinks are most fitting to your data. And it's a wonderful feature, and the results are always impressive, I think. Well, this is something that you can use, that you can solve with ML.NET and clustering. Let's say you have 10,000 good Excel spreadsheets available somewhere with data and images, diagrams. Let's say you find a way to extract raw data from those Excel sheets, from the data parts of those Excel sheets. Number of rows, number of columns, time series used, types of functions that you call, average, sum, and things like that. And then you ask ML.NET just to group those 10,000 Excel sheets into 10 or 20 clusters. Identify 10 to 20 groups of Excel sheets that more or less look the same. And you store the result of that model. You store the zip file. And then you go back to those Excel sheets again, and for each cluster, you make a top 5 of diagrams that are the most used in that cluster. And you save that in a mini Excel sheet. And the next time a user asks for a diagram, you just look up the cluster, you return the top 5, and bam, there you go. What I mean is ML.NET is, in my opinion, extremely useful in helping you cleaning up your user interface and make your user experience better. This is the trick behind clustering. I recognize some of the stuff from university in the museum, but is knowledge about that useful? Nah. This is an example of the k-means algorithm. Again, I recognize some of the symbols, but I can imagine that if someone wrote a blog post on k-means algorithm, that would enlighten me. You see that the algorithm starts with choosing, one way or another, choosing initial points, initial cluster centers. It then calculates the clusters, and then it starts shifting those points around, and as long as moving those points around gives better results, it continues on doing that. And when there is no significant change anymore in the calculation, then it stops. This little basic knowledge is enough for me as a C#. There is no significant change anymore in the calculation, then it stops. This little basic knowledge is enough for me as a C# developer to improve the code that we have until now, because every algorithm actually has its own parameters that allows you to fine-tune it. Now, in most cases, the default values of those parameters are good enough to produce decent models from the first time. They probably use machine learning to calculate those default values. But okay, if I know a little bit more, if I invested some time in learning the algorithms, Then I could tune my code here. And for the initialization algorithm, for example, it doesn't make sense to pre-calculate ideal start positions for the point, because as you saw in the graph, half of the diagrams are empty. And the chance that you start in the middle of empty, in a very bad place for a cluster center, is pretty high. So it makes sense to not pre-calculate initial positions and immediately take a random and start. So if you know more about the algorithm, you will have a model that will be trained faster, but it will not be significant better. Okay, I hope you are a little bit more convinced that ML.NET is useful, mature, easy to use, and works on your machine. Let's do another example, which is supervised learning. In this case, I provide labeled information. And instead of random dots on the left, on the right here, I also have elements with values for x1 and x2. But I also gave some extra information. Some of them are crosses, some of them are circles, some of them are diamonds, some of them are stars, whatever. And I'm going to ask a classifier to find the boundaries between them, so that when new data arrives somewhere in that chart, the model can immediately tell the expected shape. It should be a circle. I predict that it will be a square or a cross, and things like that. That is supervised learning. The example that I'm going to build is a language classification. I'm going to provide a piece of text, and the model should tell me what language it is out of 6 languages. Anybody recognizes these languages? Klingon from Star Trek, yes. Elvish from Lord of the Rings, and? No. That's actually Tibetan, the language of Tibet. That's a real language. Anyway, we're going to focus on text, not on the symbols. And the sample page from my little app looks like this. It creates a model to detect whether or not a piece of text is written in German, English, Italian, Romanian, French, or Spanish. And the model also returns for each language how easy it is for the model to detect that. Lower is better for the logarithmic loss. English is apparently very easy to recognize. Italian and German is still easy, but harder than Spanish or English. And when I provide a little text like Ceci n'est pas une pipe, that's a very famous Belgian painting, the model tells me, well, I'm 86% sure that this is French. And I will do that in less than 10 lines of code. Here's the raw data. For each language, I provide 5,000 little chunks of text. And I also provide the language. So the first number over there, the 0, is the label. So a 0 looks like German, 1 is English, etc. And again, I create an input structure to host that information. To create the model, step number 1, reading raw data, create an ML context, load the CSV into an iData view. There are, by the way, three ways to create input data. There is the CSV text loader, which is very popular in machine learning in general, but you can also provide a collection of data through a link query or an entity framework call. And last but not least, there is also a database adapter that allows you to stream data into an iData view. So there's more than comma-separated lists. Next step, choosing the algorithm. And okay, that's a little bit tougher because there are, in this domain, multi-class classification, there's more than one trainer. So yes, you have to know a little bit background about these algorithms and whether or whether not you can use them in your particular use case. Choosing the algorithm, there are a couple of parameters there. Performance is probably important. Performance of creating the model, performance of using the model. Some models have expectations about your data. They don't work very well if there are a lot of extreme values or unknown values. In some cases, explainability is important. The model should not only give a prediction, but also tell you why it make that decision. That's very important in healthcare, financial services. Your request for a loan was not granted. Well, if the bank says that to you, they should tell you why. Okay? If you get a credit limit of 50,000 and your female partner gets a credit limit of 1,000, the model should be able to explain why there is a difference or the company runs into trouble. The good news is that, particularly in the Azure ML Studio environment, there are excellent guidance documents available that help you to identify the correct algorithm for your specific scenario. Next step, preparing the data for consumption by the algorithm. I'm providing the label as a numerical value, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but I have to tell to the algorithm that it actually indicates a category, a language. It should not treat that as a real number, but as a category. So I'm going to say, use the label as a key of your internal dictionaries. Then I'm going to translate the text to numbers, and that's one call, featureized text. I don't know how it works, but it transforms your text into a series of numbers. Then I'm going to plug in the algorithm with an unpronounceable name. I'm not going to give it a try. And then at the end, I'm going to say, you know, that label that you transformed into an internal key, I want to have it back as a number, so map that key back to a value. And that's preparing the data, one line of code. Building the model is the same as for the clustering or any other type of scenario. You feed the training data into the pipeline and it will create a model for it. We are now in supervised learning. We have labeled data. I have texts and an expected language. So I can read some other texts, feed them to the model, let the model predict the language, and then compare the predictions of the model with what I actually expect to see whether or not the model is good enough. So all you have to do is call the evaluate, and that will return a group of quality metrics. And yes, again, it's up to you to relatively well understand what those quality metrics represent. Each type of problem, binary classification, regression, multi-class classification, etc., has its own quality parameters. And as I say here in the slide, you have to understand what they mean to detect whether or not they are important in your specific scenario. If you take your first steps in machine learning, you might focus a little bit too much on accuracy, the number of times that the model produces the correct result. And that's not always a good idea. Let's say you are looking for rare diseases, specific types of cancers, places on Earth where you can still find petrol or rare minerals or gold, whatever. And there is a 0.1% chance of finding it at a specific location. Well, I have a fantastic, very accurate algorithm that in 99%, 99.9% of the cases will produce the correct result. Computer says no. Always say no. Is there gold? No. Is there petrol? No. Does this patient have a specific type of cancer? No. That's a very accurate algorithm. You will never treat a patient, you will never find gold, etc. So please take a look at the alternative quality metrics for your use cases. There are cases where accuracy is the correct one. Okay, if you're happy with your model, you can optionally produce the zip file, and that's just a call to save. If that is a model that you're going to use internally in your own application, it doesn't make sense to add the required input schemes. If that's something that you're going to push to the outside world and make available to everyone, then it makes sense that your model also has in the zip file the description of how the input should look like. And okay, loading the metal, loading in your app is a call to load. Let's see what we can do with the zip file. I created a class for the prediction with the class names, a method that transforms that label from 0 to 5 into a class label. And it also gives you the output. The algorithm exposes a predicted label, but it also creates an array with the distances again. The confidence, I think it's for 80% Romanian, but it's 10% chance that it's English and a 5% chance that it's Spanish. So you have the percentages of all the language in the output. And again, I create a prediction function with a predict call. That step is always the same. And this allows me to create a language detector in C sharp in 10 lines of code for 6 languages. Okay. If you want language number 7, you want language number 8, that's very easy. Yeah? Just add more texts and labels, find 5,000 sentences in the particular language, add that to the training data, and you're gone. You're done. You can detect 7 and 8, and then next week you can detect 200 in the same 10 lines of code, which I, as a C-sharp developer, find relatively impressive. Okay? So I hope you better understand why I always saying that it's useful, mature, easy to use, and it probably will work in your .NET applications. But okay, not all of you is convinced. Allow me to do one last intervention. You easily understand that you always need the raw data somewhere, on one hand, and you always need a zip file, loading a zip file and asking questions. What if I tell you that all the rest in between, preparing the data, training the model, and testing the model, can be entirely automated using ML.NET? ML.NET comes with the so-called AutoML API, which allows you to create experiments and iterate over a number of algorithms and algorithm parameters. All you have to provide as input is the type of problem. I want to do regression, I want to do classification, I want to do multi-class classification, I want to do ranking, and so on. You specify the quality metric that is important in your specific use case, and you give it the training data. Oh, and a maximum time to try find a solution. That's actually all. That API is available as user interface in Visual Studio. If you right-click on a project, there's a menu somewhere, add machine learning, that will pop up some dialogs that allow you to configure an AutoML generation. It's also available as a command line tool, but it's also available to developers as an API, and that's what I am going to use. This is, again, one of the sample pages. I'm going to use AutoML to find for me the best algorithm to detect the quality of Portuguese white wine based on 11 physicochemical characteristics, acidity, alcohol, and things like that. And I'm just going to let AutoML create a list of experiments. And for each experiment, I draw everything in the graph. And then at the end, ML.NET will tell me what the best algorithm is, which is pretty impressive. I'm going to do that in two steps. One step to identify the one or two algorithms that produce the best result. And then a second step to play with different parameterizations of those algorithms to find me the eventual winner. Okay, again, we start at the left with the raw data and preparing the data. This is, again, a CSV file with different types of acidity, sugar, chlorides, and things like that. The density, the alcohol. And the last over there is a score that was given by professional tasters. So the 6, the 5, that's actually the label, the thing that I'm going to look for. And I prepared the data. I created a pipeline where I replaced missing values and things like that. What's missing over here is, of course, the eventual algorithm that is going to be used. And this just prepares the data and stores it in cache and things like that. Little extras to show what things you can do with the ML.NET API. Preview at the bottom, for example, is a very good for developers. If you preview an iData view and you put a breakpoint over there, you have a nice graphical overview of how the data looks like at this particular step in the scenario. That is extremely useful. And now we start AutoML. As I mentioned, all you have to do is tell it what type of experiment that you're going to do. I'm going to do a multi-class experiment. I'm going to give you, just for the demo, 3 minutes. So you have 180 seconds. And at the end, when you finish the last experiment, I want you to return me the model that came with the best logarithmic loss, which is a very nice quality metric that balances accuracy with the confidence of the model. I'm not going to allow, in this case, running experiments for two of the algorithms over there. So I removed two algorithms because I know upfront that they don't suit my use case. To be honest, those are two algorithms that don't work very well in UWP, and that's the reason why I removed them. But okay, it's just an example. And then I create, with a very long method call, I create a multi-class classification experiment. Next step is running that experiment. So for 180 seconds, after that execute call, ML.NET will create a model, train the model, test the model, raise an event each time with details about the model that was just tested. That's how I was able to put it in a diagram. You know, all the quality metrics, you get all the quality metrics, the time that it took, and so on. And after those 180 seconds, the best run property of that experiment hosts the model that you can save to a zip file. And this is how it looks in my little sample app. You see that it tries a lot of different things. I was looking in the logarithmic loss, so that peak over there at 1.6 is definitely not the winner. I also see the other metrics. The red curve is the is that the log loss reduction? Yes, I see for one particular case that it is below zero. That metric indicates how much better your model is than just randomly producing an output. So there's one model over there that is worse than just randomly giving a score to the white Portuguese wine. That will certainly not be the winner. But okay, on the other hand, you see that I was looking for the log loss, which is the yellow curve. Most of them over there are in the 1.2 area, which is not too bad. But I decided to make a second run with exactly the same code, but only for the winner of the previous step. And in that case, instead of selecting different algorithms, AutoML will use that algorithm and select different hyperparameters, different parameterizations of the same algorithm. And again, I'm going to give 3 minutes time to do that. So instead of removing trainers, I did the clear. Remove all the trainers and then add the winner of the previous step. And this is the result. And as you saw in the first run, the log loss was consistently around 1.2. And now most of the models have a better result. I can imagine that if you create a model yourself, if you decide the parameters, if you decide the algorithm, then you will trust the zip file. If AutoML produces a model for you, it makes sense to look into the zip file. You would want, as a developer, look what was created for you. Unfortunately, most of the properties over here are private. So there is no easy way yet to discover the internals of the resulting model. That means that you should rely on techniques like reflection or use the Visual Studio Debugger that allows you to dig into the details of every model. Okay, let's wrap up. ML.NET will allow you to solve some at first sight unprogrammable issues in your code. I really suggest that you take a look in your applications that you are building and maintaining today and find excuses to use ML.NET in them. Okay? For example, recommendation, we are not all of us are Netflix and Amazon, but recommendation is also a way to pre-populate combo boxes in input forms. And I've used ML.NET very successfully in that domain. So it is useful. Although it is relatively new, it works, it is mature. Your team definitely has the skills to start working with it, and it will work on your machine. And I'm sorry to have used the time allow questions in order to finish my story, but okay, I will remain available until the end of the conference. Feel free to harass me in the corridors and ask questions, start discussions. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.